translations and so forth. And our eighth class and our last class, and this is March the 4th, 1997. Did all of you, to begin with here, did all of you get this asceticism and monasticism? Here, monasticism. Okay, here's one. Did the rest of you all got one, haven't you? Okay. What we're going to try to cover here, if we can, I wanted to throw one thing out because we didn't cover this as far as the new translations and so forth. We did not say much about it concerning the New World Translation, and that by Jehovah's Witnesses. I'm going to read from the preface of the 1950 edition here. It says, the Greek text that we have used as the basis of our New World Translation is widely accepted Westcott and Hort text of 1881. And then it goes on down, by reason of its admitted excellence, but we have also taken into consideration other texts, including that prepared by D. Eberhard Nessel. Does that ring a bell? Sure does, doesn't it? I mean, the red flag goes up, doesn't it, huh? Then it goes on to say, we offer no paraphrase of the scriptures. Our endeavor all through has been to give as literal a translation as possible. And this here, I checked, this is, has the same things missing as what the new revised edition of the New World Translation is. It has, for the same thing in Matthew chapter 17, verse 21, verses missing. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 11, the verse is missing. Mark chapter 9 and verse 44 and 46, verses are missing. They're not there at all. And it has almost, because it almost parallels exactly, with the exception there's a little rewording and so forth, because this is copyrighted as your NIV and that. So if any of you get an opportunity to pick up at a garage sale or something a New World Translation, you need to get that and put it in your library and have it. You need to go through some of these verses here. And also, something you can memorize, so it's very easy to do. Matthew chapter, what is the verse now? Chapter 17, verse what? 21. Matthew chapter 18, verse 11. Right. And also, it has the same thing missing as far as Luke chapter 4, verse 4. What's missing from Luke 4, 4? Good. Luke chapter 4, verse 8. Get thee behind me, Satan. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. You guys got this down pat. I'll tell you, all of that's missing from the New World Translation, almost identical to everything you have in the NIV and that. So the only difference here, they put like manuscript A, manuscript D. Manuscript D is a corrupt manuscript. And the Syriac and so forth omitted. And then they've got this in the footnote. Now in the New World Translation, with your newer editions, they don't put any of that in there whatsoever, and the whole introduction is missing from your new World Translation, the new ones that are put out. Only one I know of is the 1950 that has that in there about Westcott and Hort. And evidently, I was sort of interesting when we met with Keith and Anna, and they had the two Jehovah's Witnesses there on last Saturday. I was shocked, a little shocked myself. I was sort of curious to see if they knew that these verses were missing. So when we started, I asked them when it came my turn. I said, asked the young lady there. I said, young, about 30. I said, will you look up Matthew chapter 17, verse 21? So she's going to her Bible, getting it. You look up Matthew 18:11. He's going to his Bible, getting it. I said, read that to me now. And they were shocked, absolutely. And I said, well, what's there? Why won't you read it? And, I said, no, what's there? What? Read the verse to me. And I'm sort of pressing the point a little bit. Well, there's just a line. I said, well, what's the line say? Well, the line don't say anything. There's just a line there. In here, the earlier edition, they don't even have a line. They just skip the verse and then put it in a footnote. In your later translation or your revised edition, they just put a straight line about like that. And that's all there is to it. Okay, we've got some material we're going to cover. I want to cover in your notes, you have all of this here, but I want to cover here for the tape's sake here and those taking the course here by, taking that are not in the classroom here. We want to cover here the Latin Vulgate. I want to cover the Wycliffe and the William Tyndale, and also the Matthew's Bible to let you know, show you a little bit about these two men and so forth. of where these old translations, these came here primarily now, except the Latin Vulgate, from the received text, same thing as your King James was translated from. Then we'll come on back here and want to cover some of the things here about from the fall of Rome to 476 A.D., and fall of Rome in 476 A.D. from Christ up until that time, those first 450 or 70 years, to show you the same thing we want to go over about the same battle that they had back there with Montanism, Gnosticism, and so forth. Same battle you have today about the deity of Christ. Same thing. Jehovah's Witnesses did not believe that Jesus Christ is God. And the same battle you have. Mormons do not believe that Jesus Christ is God. And it's the same battle they had right after Christ ascended back to heaven. The rage began. The battle began. And it has never stopped in 2,000 years. That will be the battle you fight all of your life. And you'll be hated for it because you will be listed as a heretic. And we'll read you when we get on back here about what they called some of these men here, especially Wycliffe. It'd be interesting to see what they called him. But if you want to follow, if you have that, you can follow along here. But we have to give, I want to give most of this information out here. The Vulgate means common or current. It is a version of the entire Bible into the Latin. At the Roman Catholic Council of Trent in 1545 to 63, the name Vulgate was given to Jerome's version as the standard authoritative Bible of the Latin, or the Roman Church, translated it or edited by Jerome. It was made at the end of the 4th century, the New Testament in about 383 to 384 A.D., the Old Testament from about 390 to 405. What was the need? The old Latin text had been copied and recopied many times by independent and unauthorized individuals who possessed a Greek manuscript and some familiarity with both languages. They were not scholars, and their copies were filled with errors. They had additions, they had omissions, and changes due to hand copying with scarcely any two alike. The Old Testament was a translation from a translation, not from the Hebrew. Damascus, in the year 366 to 389, the Pope, as the Bishop of Rome had by this time come to be called, was interested in the scriptures and a friend of scholars. There was a need for the standard authoritative text. Damascus called Jerome. He was a friend of Jerome, 382 A.D., and he went to Rome, and at Damascus' request, he undertook the work here to put the translation here into the Latin. Jerome, his Latin name is Eusebius Hieronymus, or Hieronymus, and he was born at Stridon, Dalmatica, about the year 340 to 342. He died in Bethlehem in the year 420 A.D. His parents were supposed to be Christians and gave him a good classical education. He had a good foundation in Greek and began a collection of a library for a pretty educated fella. At Rome, he studied Latin and rhetoric under the best. A short time later, he went to Gaul, as France, and began a serious study of theology. He went to Antioch, where during an attack of fever, he had a dream which caused him to abandon his studies. And in the dream, he was summoned to judgment and asked who he was. His answer, this was in a dream now, he said, "I'm a Christian." And a stern answer said, "You're not a Christian, for where your heart is, there your treasure is also." From Antioch, he went into a nearby desert, and he spent 5 years from 374 to 379 in severe self-discipline and diligent study, including the Hebrew under a converted Jewish rabbi. In the year 379 A.D., he returned to Antioch. Then he went to Constantinople, where he probably continued his study in Greek. In 382 A.D., he returned to Rome and became secretary and a close friend of Pope Damascus and began the preparation for the Latin Vulgate. At this time, he was an excellent Latin scholar and writer, a good Greek scholar, and pretty fair at Hebrew. The translation in 383 A.D., he had revised the Gospels somewhat sparingly in order to avoid too much opposition. Early the next year, 384, the remainder of the New Testament more hastily revised and appeared. In 384, Damascus died, and Jerome had won the favor of several noble ladies in Rome by his plain preaching and attractive teaching of asceticism. One was by the name of Paula, a widow, and her three daughters. This teaching produced many, many enemies. You talk about the priest and the phony baloney of this asceticism today. And you talk about the priest not being married, and you condemn it as the Bible does. What do you get? You're a heretic, aren't you? I mean, can people believe that this dedicated man who's a priest, who is not married and loves God so much, and all of this, which is projected to society today, can society accept the fact that this man is not a dedicated, intelligent man who knows the Bible inside and out? And how could anybody say anything against his dedication to God? Well, it's phony baloney. First of all, the people are so dumb, they don't know anything about the Bible. They're taught they shouldn't ask the priest, because that would be an insult to him. He is the ultimate in the Scriptures. And if they were to sit down, they'd find out he knows hardly anything about the Scriptures. And all of this stuff about not being married and so forth is actually a doctrine of a demon. Doesn't it say in 1 Timothy chapter 4, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter days some shall depart from the faith, giving heed, listening to doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and abstain from eating meats which God's created to be received with thanksgiving of them that believe and know the truth." So instead of taking the Bible, which condemns that as a satanic practice, which is only a form of godliness but no power thereof, you try to convince that to anyone who doesn't want to know the truth. You're wasting your time. Look at the area you're in. Look at this area here. You're like talking to a brick wall because you got zombies running around. Intelligent men in business, but when it comes to spiritual things, don't know beans from apple butter. And you know what? They will never know. They'll die in their sins, because you've got to have a will to know the will of God. John 7:17, "If any man's will is to know his will or to do his will, it shall be made known unto him." So unless a person has an incentive to know and want to know, then the gospel and Satan has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ should shine unto them. When we preach only one way to heaven, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness." And you say, well, how does that apply today? Well, is the cross of Jesus Christ how religion is going to heaven? No. There's only few that believe compared to the populace. "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness." How many people have you ever told, you know, there's only one way to heaven? Christ said, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man come unto the Father except through the Son." And yet, only through the cross do you have eternal life. Only through the death, burial, and resurrection do you have eternal life. And yet, Paul warned in Galatia in France, he said, you know, this is another gospel, which is not another. Yes, they talk about the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, but it includes something else, which actually does away with the gospel, although they name the gospel, but they don't believe the gospel, because they say they believe the gospel, but you have to have this. You got to confess to the priest. You got to do this. You got to, one thing or another, you got to do it, and so forth. So we come on down and begin to find out that he says here, he sort of compromised on the text so he didn't change too many things, or it would become too obvious in the translation. So in one way, some things were a good translation. Other things were not really. They were sort of went along with the Septuagint and that. All right. 384, Damascus died, as we said. Jerome had won the favor. Some ladies there and so forth. In 385, he and Paula and one of her daughters left for Palestine after a season of study in Egypt under the famous teacher of Didymus, Didymus the Blind. They settled in Bethlehem in 386. Here they built a monastery in 389, over which Jerome ruled, and a nunnery over which Paula ruled. And then a Roman psalter, having been much used and carelessly copied, needed a revision. That's the Psalms. Jerome was urged to make it. Therefore arose about 387 A.D. the Gallican psalter, so called because of his popularity in Gaul or France. About the same time, he began his translation of the Old Testament from the Septuagint, as he has written. Only Job and Psalms have come down to us. His increasing study and knowledge of the Hebrew enabled him to realize the unsatisfactory condition of the existing Septuagint and the old Latin text, therefore a revision from the Hebrew. He spent the next 15 years, 390 to 405, in making a new revision, not in authorized as by the king, but as a private enterprise. You got to remember, when you have these translations, how many did we have to translate the King James Bible? We had 54, and then we ended up with 46. Some died before it was finished and so forth. And the difference between these good translations or the good translation of the King James, when you got 44, 46 men translating as compared to one man, you see the difference? One man is compared to 46. Well, that makes quite a bit of difference, doesn't it, when you have that many doing it. But it was a private enterprise. About halfway through, he suffered a long illness, but in 398, he continued until the Old Testament was complete in 405 A.D., and he died in Bethlehem in the year 420. Therefore, the Latin Bible of Jerome, which came to be known as the Vulgate, was a composite work of four parts. We'll give you these four here. See how much more we got? Not much. The Old Testament, except the Psalter, a translation from the original Hebrew. This is when the storm of indignation and opposition broke loose. In those days, you've got to remember, the Septuagint was considered inspired and authoritative. It would be like today when we're talking about the American Bible with your Roman Catholic Church, or we're talking about your New World Translation with Jehovah's Witnesses, or your NIV. We're right here today, all over the world, the NIV. You say anything against the NIV, and people think that they've had such a snow job and a brainwashing, they think this is actually the Word of God, because it's been sold lucratively for the money and the ripoff. And this is the same thing that Jerome did here, because the Septuagint was considered as an absolute authority by the church. That's it. You say anything against the NIV today, and what do you get? Oh, do you know what you're talking about? Why, everybody loves the NIV. It's easier to read. It's the best on the market. We've all got it and everything like that. You bunch of ignoramuses. You've never taken time to study it. This Jehovah's Witness when we pointed this out. And this woman had the gall to say, well, everything you've told us about that with Westcott Hart, all that thing you've told us, I've already studied out and I know all of that. Only problem is, if you knew it, then you've accepted a counterfeit, so your judgment isn't any good. And either that or you lied. I said, I doubt that very much. But no wonder they were storming, and they were storming. But she didn't know that at all. But she's going to defend what she has been given to her, just as even your Baptist preachers do today with the NIV. What a shame, isn't it? Been sold a bill of goods. The Roman Church accused him of unlawful innovations, sacrilege, disturbing the peace of the church, shaking the foundations of her faith, and so forth. His hot temper and stinging words of his tongue and pen added fire to the flames. Jerome was quite spicy. He let them fly back, you know. In his introduction to the various books, he was neither slow nor mild in his replies of the two-legged donkeys, as he called the ignorant priest. And you two-legged donkeys. So he fired them back, you know. The Psalter, that is the Psalms, the Old Latin, revised from the Septuagint. This was the Gallican Psalter, first used and widely circulated in Greek. It was revised from the Septuagint with the help of the other Greek versions. It was finally under Pope Pius V in 1566 to 1572, adopted by the Roman Church and is embodied in the Vulgate. The Gospels, the Old Latin, revised from the original Greek. Only important alterations were made. Smaller blunders and inaccuracies were left uncorrected in order that, as far as possible, the familiar language they were used to would remain undisturbed. The remainder of the New Testament, being still less changed, provoked little opposition. The remainder of the New Testament, the Old Latin, more hastily and superficially revised. The Apocrypha. Jerome did not desire to translate these books because they were not in the Hebrew canon, and he did not consider them canonical. Yet he did yield, after much pressure from friends, to make a hasty translation. Final triumph. Gradually, the opposition subsided. Augustine, who had previously refused to allow it to be read in the churches, now turned from criticism to praise. Jerome died sorely grieved by the fierce criticism of his work. What a shame this disappointed old man could not have lived a few more years to see the triumph of his translation. By the 7th century, his translation was the Bible in use. The Latin Vulgate continued to be the Bible of the Western Europe and North Africa and was the source of many other translations down to the time of the Reformation beginning in 1517. The sad part, when you see what Jerome did, some parts were not bad translation. Most of it was not really that good. He couldn't make too many drastic changes because he would get crucified by the Roman Catholic Church and so forth from already using the Septuagint. So then other translations came, and they translated from already a not good translation of the Latin Vulgate. So you had using a not very good translation and yet making translations off of a not very good translation, and you begin to see how some of these translations got perverted. Do you see, follow what I'm saying? Okay, the Latin language and Latin Bible held sway for about 1,000 years over the Western world. The Mazarine, we put this in here to let you know, if you hear this, you'll know what it is. John Gutenberg of Mainz, Germany, is said to have invented the printing press 1450, and in 1454 he invented the printing from movable type. The first book from the press was the Latin Vulgate, 1455, called the Mazarine Bible. Why? The reason was because copies of it were found in the library of Cardinal Mazarin at Paris. That's why they call it the Mazarine Bible. Now we come to Wycliffe, and you're going to see what the church says about him. Jerome said, you two-legged donkeys, he called the priest, but we're going to see what the priests call Wycliffe now. And when we get on back, they're sort of interesting. He turned over in his grave, but I'm going to show you what hatred will do. And you can understand why when you come to Walnut Grove and you start a Bible-teaching church and you say, don't confess your sins to the priest. That Lutheran preacher cannot forgive your sins. Stands up there every Sunday morning and says, I forgive your sins in the name of Jesus Christ. Along comes a preacher and says, don't listen to that phony baloney. You understand why they hate you? They don't hate me because of me and my pleasant personality, my wonderful disposition, my lovable attitude. They hate me because of what I stand for. And that's what they hate you for. In John chapter 15, Christ said, the world doesn't hate you because of you. They hate you because of me. That's why. And if they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. So that's why in a day we're living in, right now today, before the rapture, we need Christians that's got backbone, that's not going to be afraid to be talked about or anything else, to stand up and lead other people to Jesus Christ and say, I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. If we ever needed Christians, we need them now that have backbone. It's sad to say, a local person here just hadn't been here too long, in a position of influence, and is afraid to come to our church because of the pressure being put on him. Afraid to do that. Afraid he may lose his job. Afraid he's afraid. And how sad, isn't it? Really, isn't that sad? Isn't it really sad? And the reason I know that is I called one of his relatives. And so I'm going to find out what's going on, you know. I know what's going on. Wycliffe, here we go, all right? Wycliffe's version is the first complete translation of the Bible into English language from the Latin Vulgate. New Testament in 1380, the Old Testament in 1382. John Wycliffe, 1320, born 1384, was born in Yorkshire, England, and died in Lutterworth. I don't know how you pronounce that word. That's got too many letters for me. I thought it was Leicestershire. Leicestershire? Huh? Leicestershire. There we go. That's at Leicestershire. I thought I had it right. stumble on that one. England was a Roman Catholic country at this time. Who would rule England, the king or the pope? That was the question. There was quite a conflict there. The pope demanded payment from the king, and Wycliffe took the people's side. As one of the king's chaplains, he made a notable reply in 7 brief, vigorous statements denying all rights of the pope to demand the people to pay tribute to the church. In Wycliffe's time, it took a copyist 10 months to produce 1 copy of the Bible, his Bible. The Wycliffe Bible is a manuscript Bible written before the invention of the printing, 1450. Wycliffe's early life, he graduated from Oxford University approximately in the year 1351. He, in 1356, became fellow of Merton Hall in Oxford. That was a good position. 1365, warden of Canterbury Hall. 1367, he received degree of the Doctorate of Theology. 1374, he was appointed rector of Lutterworth, where he lived until his death. He was called the Morning Star of the Reformation and also called the first Protestant. He took a strong stand against Roman Catholicism. He opposed the papacy. In 1377, he issued a statement of heresies in 19 articles and laid it before the pope. That took a lot of guts, didn't it? The pope, in return, Pope Urban V, issued 5 bulls against him. You know what 5 bulls are? Huh? 5 judgments. You've had it, pard. The Pope has spoken, you know. And a council was held in the Archbishop's Palace at Lambeth, and Wycliffe defended his position by scripture. Government officials and the populace of London broke into the meeting, closing the conference and setting Wycliffe free. Wycliffe's theology: he condemned one's trust in good works, he denounced the priest's power to pardon the indulgence and their absolutions, he called the sale of indulgence a subtle merchandise of Antichrist clerks to magnify their counterfeit power and to get worldly goods, and to cause men not to dread sin. He laid it on the line, didn't he? Now, this is clear back here. Now, you see, the same men back there had the same problem you and I do today, standing for the Word of God. Has anything changed? Not a thing, has it? He called the sale of those subtle merchandise of the Antichrist clerks. He denounced works and merits and prayers to the saints as wild blasphemy, as Christ is the only mediator. He was labeled anathema by the papacy for condemning the Eucharist teaching of transubstantiation. You know what transubstantiation is? And one thing some of you do. Anybody doesn't know what transubstantiation is? Let me see your hand, and I'll tell you. Okay. Transubstantiation, when the preacher came up and said, this is the body of Christ, this is the bread of Christ, and so forth, and this is his body. You're partaking of his body. Okay? That priest, and it is in their writings, I have in my library, they teach. That priest has the power. The minute that hits your mouth, you are eating the literal body of Christ that was here 2,000 years ago. Did you know that? How do you disprove that? They go to John. They say, well, this is my body, and so forth, in my blood. Take, eat, and do this in remembrance of me. Eat my body. Well, if you go to Matthew at the Last Supper there, you'll find out, and this is how you disprove it, that it's used metaphorically. You go to Matthew chapter 26 at the Last Supper, and Christ was alive right before he went to the cross, was he not? He handed them bread, and he said, take, eat, this is my body. So he handed them the bread to eat and said, this is my body, right? He didn't say, this is my arm, take a chunk out of it, pard. You understand what I'm saying? But when they go over to John, you remember the Last Supper in Matthew chapter 26 and go there immediately and disprove it. That's how you disprove it. You understand what I'm saying? That's how you disprove it. Because it isn't that clear, you can take it and make it mean anything you want over in John. And the same thing in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. But when you come to Matthew in the Last Supper, he's alive. And he took the bread, and he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, eat the bread, this is my body. So that's the verse that shows the bread is his body, not the literal eating of his body, which the priests take upon themselves and say, this is the literal body of Christ that he walked on this earth, and I have the power. When you take it, you're eating the body of Jesus Christ. That would be cannibalism. That is what kind of false religion you have in Roman Catholicism. You understand what I'm saying? Most priests I've talked to don't believe it. They just go through it. There are a few that do, but the majority of the priests don't believe it when you pin them down. He was labeled anathema by the papacy. Transubstantiation, he committed the unpardonable sin by teaching that Christ's resurrected body remains in heaven and is not present in the element of the Eucharist. He was brought to trial at Oxford in 382, and the power of the papacy and his clerical enemies was so strong that he was expelled from the Oxford University. His teaching there was ended, but he was permitted to return to his quiet parsonage at Lutterworth until his death. Wycliffe's death. On December the 28th, 1384, while conducting a service in the Lutterworth Church, he was suddenly stricken with paralysis, probably from overwork. He was carried out and never spoke again. He died December the 31st, 1384. He was a great and a brave scholar, a patriot, and a lover of the gospel. He believed in the right and the duty of everyone to read the scriptures for themselves, and the best way for the people to break the power of Romanism was to place a Bible in the hands of the people. Then, his translation was from the Latin Vulgate into the English. The New Testament was completed about 1380, and the Old Testament about 1382. Part of the Old Testament was done by one of his disciples and fellow workers, one Nicholas de Harford. He was suddenly summoned to London, charged with heresy, and excommunicated. After Wycliffe's death, about 4 years in 1388, a revision was made of the whole Bible. It was the work of John Purvey, Wycliffe's former curate at Lutterworth. It had a wide circulation, was copied by hand, and the rich paid sometimes as much as $300, which would be equivalent to our money for just a copy. One historian tells that a whole load of hay was paid for the use of a complete New Testament for just one day, just to read it. His influence. He instituted and he superintended an order of itinerant preachers who went from town to town throughout England, preaching, teaching, and reading the English Bible to the common people. They preached everywhere, passing out tracts and pamphlets. Many were Oxford University grads and had caught Wycliffe's faith and zeal. They were not church clergy, but voluntary workers working with clergy where possible, otherwise working independently. The nickname Lollards, and we put this in here so if you ever hear that, you know where it come from. The nickname Lollards probably came from the old German Lollen, that is to sing softly, referring to their singing of psalms and hymns, or from the Middle English Loller Vagabond, as they were called. Within 10 years after Wycliffe's death, they had become a power, attacking Romanish doctrines and practices and demanding the Parliament to make drastic reforms. The Roman Church passed a series of laws against heresy, and a period of torture and persecution was inaugurated against these so-called heretics. Many godly men were imprisoned and put to death. His enemies, the Roman Catholic Church. Here is a description of his death by one of his monk enemies. Oh boy, here we go. This is what one of the monk enemies said. On the day of St. Thomas the Martyr, Archbishop of Canterbury, John Wycliffe, the organ of the devil, the enemy of the church, the confusion of the common people, the idol of heretics, the looking glass of hypocrites, the messenger of sechism, that is division, the sower of hatred, the storehouse of lies, the sink of flattery, was suddenly struck by the judgment of God and had all of his limbs seized with the palsy. That mouth which was to speak high things against God and against his saints or holy church was miserably drawn aside and afforded a frightful spectacle to the beholders. His tongue was speechless, his head shook, showing painfully that the curse which God had thundered forth against Cain was also inflicted on him. That was for trying to get the Bible into people's hands. Pretty vicious. Archbishop Arundo complained to the Pope of that pestilent wretch, John Wycliffe, the son of the old serpent, the forerunner of the Antichrist, who had completed his iniquity by inventing a new translation of the Scriptures. Oh boy. In 1415, the Council of Constance, which consigned John Huss and Jerome of Prague to a cruel death, demanded that the bones of the notorious heretic Wycliffe be taken out of consecrated ground and scattered at a distance from the sepulchre. No one was found to carry out the decree. Nobody would do it. And then 13 years later, 1428, 44 years after Wycliffe's death, Clement VIII ordered no further delay. The grave was torn up, his bones were burned, and his ashes thrown into the River Swift, name of the river. Wycliffe's influence continued. His words and fame went all over Europe. His teaching spread to Bohemia, stirred John Huss and Jerome, whose martyrdom set all Bohemia on fire. He was the only English Bible for 145 years. Wycliffe's translation, English, existed in about 170 manuscript copies, of which 30 contained the original translation of 1382. The remaining 140 purveys revision of 1388, all written before 1430. In 1850, two English scholars, Forshell and Madden, about 22 years of labor on the 170 manuscripts, published the entire Bible in four large quarto volumes. An excellent reprint of the New Testament was made in 1879. As a sample of his English, the following is the translation of the Lord's Prayer. This is how the Old English was. Our Father, which art in heaven ease, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come me to, be thy will done in heaven, so in earthy, and so on. You can read it. But this was how the Old English read. See, you see how the languages sometimes have been revised on up as we have it today? Do you see? This was the Old English there. Then we come to Tyndale translation, all right? Let's go on over here. There was 145 years between Wycliffe and Tyndale. There became a need again for a standardized Bible. William Tyndale, born in 1484 on Friday, October the 6th, 1536, he was executed. In 1536, he was executed. He was strangled while being tied to the stake, then his body burned. He was probably born in Gloucestershire, England, in about 1484. His country had been evangelized by Wycliffe and his followers. He was skilled in Greek and Latin. He studied Greek and theology under the renowned New Testament scholar Erasmus, who taught at Cambridge University from 1511 to 1514. Erasmus' Greek New Testament appeared in 1516. But Tyndale wanted the people to have a translation in their own language, English. He left London. He sailed to Hamburg, Germany in May 1524 in exile for his faith, never to see his homeland again. Now, I've just really condensed this down. You ought to sometime read a whole history on William Tyndale. So I'm just really condensed it down just to give you the very highlights here. After a short stay, he went to Wittenberg, where he visited Luther, saw the Reformation in full swing, seeing the people reading the Bible in their own language. Here he translated some of the New Testament using Erasmus' Greek Testament, the third edition, 1522, his Latin translation, and Luther's German translation. He proceeded to Cologne, where his work was printed by some who had business connections with England. They could produce and transmit the books quickly and cheaply. 3,000 copies were to be printed. There's a lot of things that went in between this here. This is just the highlights. The city senate, devoted to Rome, found out about Tyndale's work and ordered the printers to stop. He left. He went to Worms. Now, these cities here, that's Worms, Germany, which was a thriving German city and strong for Luther and the Reformation. In October 1525, he reached the city and his New Testament was printed. Early in 1526, his New Testament began to pass into England, concealed in cases of merchandise, barrels, bolts of cloth, sacks of flour and corn, and every secret way possible. Approximately 18,000 copies were printed between 1525 and 1528. He also wrote three other great works, and this got him into a lot of trouble. The Parable of the Wicked Mammon. This was a treatise on the doctrine of justification by faith, no works involved. The Practice of the Prelates, this got him into trouble. Here he denounced King Henry VIII's divorce of Catherine in favor of Anne Boleyn. He couldn't have any children but her. And Anne Boleyn, who was the aunt of Charles V. She was friendly to the reformers, but her uncle, Charles V, was a strict Roman Catholic, and he hated Tyndale and the reformers. Under him, it was a crime punishable by torture, burning, or burial alive for anyone to read, to purchase, or to possess any New Testament books, and for any lack of respect to the images and the saints. Those in opposition were labeled heretics. Is there anything different today? We come here to Walnut Grove and say, hey, don't make these images out here. You don't have to do this. And we're a cult church. Is there anything any different? Nothing, is there? Not one thing different. Obedience of a Christian man. And this got him in trouble too. And that was, he covered freedom of the country from the Pope and suppression of the monasteries. So boy, he let him have it, didn't he? At Antwerp, Germany, he spent his last 2 years. He was betrayed by a so-called friend while dining with him. He was arrested as a heretic. His house was confiscated of all of his books and possessions. He was taken to the castle of Vilvoorde, the great state prison of the Low Countries, 18 miles from Antwerp, and he remained there 16 months until he was executed. While in prison, he led to Christ the keeper, his daughter, and others of the household. He was skilled in 7 languages, Hebrew, Greek, Latin, Italian, Spanish, English, and Dutch. Wherever language that he was speaking, you would have thought it would have been his native tongue. Hardly comparable to any of these so-called scholars we have today, is it? Hardly. We scarcely realize the horrible cost in suffering and deprivation it was to a man with the great ambition to give the people the living word in their own language. And little do we know how much that we owe this great heroic scholar, pure and unselfish martyr, by the name of William Tyndale. Before Tyndale's death, he appointed his friend as a literary executor. His name was John Rogers, who had a B.A. degree from Cambridge. He published Tyndale's translation from the Greek and Hebrew to the English under the name of Thomas Matthew, which is also known as the Matthew's Bible. Now, we're going on over here, and we have time here. I'm going to hit the Matthew's Bible. We only got just a little bit on it, and then we'll take our break, all right? We'll go over here. In between here, we had the Coverdale Bible, but there's not too much you have the information on that. But let's get here to the Matthew's Bible. The compiler, John Rogers, a B.A. at Cambridge, 1525. 1534, he left England. He went to Antwerp, Germany, where he became friends with Tyndale. Before Tyndale was martyred, he had appointed his friend, as we have said, his literary executor. He gathered all of Tyndale's work of translation into one volume. He furnished it with introductions, summaries of chapters, and some controversial marginal notes. It is known as the first revision of Tyndale Bible. He knew that if the name William Tyndale and that of his associates should appear with a title, that it would hinder the sale of the Bible by the king and the queen. He therefore used the name Thomas Matthew, and it became known as the Matthew's Bible. It's not known whether this was a pseudonym of John Rogers or the name of a helper or that of some merchant who backed the work financially. Nobody knows. But anyway, Thomas Matthew is where we get the Matthew's Bible. It is thought to have been printed at Antwerp and sent over to England in sheets to be completed by the printers in London. It arrived at the London printers, Whitechurch and Grafton. Grafton handed it over to Cranmer. That was bishop and advisor to Henry, who passed it on to Cromwell, and that was a bishop and advisor to Henry also. Now, if we recapitulate, before we go any further, to see how Cranmer and Cromwell and Anne Boleyn's influence played an important part in getting the Matthew's Bible authorized for sale by King Henry VIII, who was in favor of Roman Catholicism. His new wife, remember this, Anne Boleyn, she was in favor of the Reformers. She was for Tyndale. The king was not. Her husband wasn't. 1525, about Cardinal Wolsey, minister to King Henry, was a strict Roman Catholic, as was Fisher, Bishop of Rochester, England, and Bishop Sir Thomas More. Charles V was emperor of the whole country, including Germany. He was a strict Roman Catholic also, hated the Reformers. The city of Worms, Germany, was strong for Luther and the Reformers, which the emperor had to put up with. I mean, he couldn't overthrow it. It was too strong. Cardinal Wolsey died. Thomas Cromwell became the chief advisor to Henry. Cromwell was in favor of Tyndale. Cromwell agreed with Tyndale that the supremacy of the Pope should be suppressed. Then, with his influence, he influenced the king, and the king agreed. Cromwell had influenced King Henry VIII to ask Tyndale to come to England. Stephen Vaughan was sent to Germany to induce Tyndale to come back to England and to write some more about the suppression of the Pope. Cromwell had Henry read Tyndale's, and this was a mistake, Obedience of a Christian Man, which endorsed the freedom of the country from the Pope and suppression of the monasteries. This was the reason the king wanted him to come and write some more. Tyndale declined. Meanwhile, Tyndale wrote, the practice of the prelates, this is what I was referring to a minute ago, practice of the prelates, which denounced Henry was for the other appear, but when he wrote the practice of the prelates, which denounced Henry's divorce as a wicked attempt of the clergy to tamper with the law of God, oh boy, that caused the problem. It's like John the Baptist. What did John the Baptist say to King Agrippa? What did he say? Or Antipas? Wasn't it Antipas? Antipas, he said, it's unlawful for you to marry your brother's wife. What happened to him? Decapitated. That's all for John. That's all she wrote. And you know what? We say here in Walnut Grove, and this upsets people, you know, you got one foot in the bar on Saturday night, and you go to church Sunday morning, you big bunch of hypocrites. You got a form of godliness, no power thereof. You go out with somebody else's wife and go to bed with her. We got more of that going on. This is like Peyton Place here in Walnut Grove. Wonder somebody don't end up getting shot. They don't like that too much. We had a lady who used to live down by.